În România, unul dintre domeniile asupra căreia jurisprudența Curții Europene a Drepturilor Omului a avut un impact direct și semnificativ este dreptul de proprietate. Drept care s-a regăsit în cuprinsul tuturor legilor fundamentale, sub o formă sau alta, respectiv garantat și ocrotit sau dimpotrivă de a fi îngrădit.
In Romania, the area pertaining to the right to property has been majorly influenced by the case law of the European Court of Human Rights. The right to property is enshrined in all basic laws under a form or another, guaranteed and protected, or, on the contrary, restricted. In fact, one of fundamental rights enshrined by the 1991 Constitution of Romania was the right to property, respectively the protection of private property. To be shorter, I shall translate. After the revolution of 1989, a set of laws were adopted under the constitutional provisions aimed at the restitution of property abusively taken by communist state authorities, as well as a number of reparation laws. In this respect, is it worth mentioning law number 112 from 1995 on the status of certain residential property transferred into state ownership, Law number 10 per 2001 on the legal status of property confiscated between 6 March 1945 and 22 December 1989, Government Emergency Ordinance number 83 per 1999 on the restitution of property that belonged to communities of national minorities, Government Emergency Ordinance number 94 per 2000 on the restitution of property that belonged to the Romanian religious cults, or law number 247 of 19 July 2005 on the reform in property and justice and related measures. It turned out, however, that the infraconstitutional regulation of the right to property was neither appropriate nor sufficient, and the consequence was the Romanian state has been repeatedly condemned by the European Court of Human Rights, especially for lack of foreseeability of legal rules, for delaying the restoration of the right to property and existence of multiple parallel and concurrent normative acts, etc. Thus, we mention some of the judgment delivered by the European Court of Human Rights against Romania. The judgment of 22 May 1998, delivered in the case Vasilescu versus Romania. The judgment of 26 November 2002, delivered in the case Kanchovic and others versus Romania. The judgment of the 1st December 2005, delivered in the case Păduraru versus Romania. The judgment of 26 January 2006, delivered in the case Lungoc versus Romania. Relevant in this context seems to be the judgment of 1st December 2005 in the case Păduraru versus Romania. In the judgment delivered in the case Păduraru versus Romania, the European Court noted that the applicant brought an action for recovery of property, seeking both a declaration that the nationalization of his whole building has been unlawful and that buildings return. In its judgment of 10 April 1997, which became final, the Bucharest Court of First Instance established that the property concerned has been nationalized in breach of nationalization decree number 92 per 1950, that the applicant remained the legitimate owner and ordered the state to return the property to him. This judgment in kind. This judgment was binding on the state, the only legal person which could legitimately claim to be owner of the property at that date and which was ordered to return the building to the applicant. The European Court of Human Rights held that the title which was thus recognized with retrospective effect was irrevocable. Furthermore, the applicant's title had not been overturned or challenged at the time when the Court of Strasbourg delivered its judgment, and the government expressly recognized that the applicant remains the owner and has based their defense on that hypothesis. The European Court therefore considered that with regard to flat number 2, the applicant had the possession within the meaning of Article 1 of Protocol number 1 to the Convention. On whether there was an interference, the European Court noted that the Bucharest Court of First Instance found that the nationalization of the applicant's building had been illegal and ordered the state, which was in possession of the building at the material time, to return it to the applicant. But 6 days after that judgment, the state sold flat number 2 to the tenant. In assessing compliance with Article 1 of Protocol number 1, the court had to make an overall examination of the various interests in issue, bearing in mind that the convention is intended to safeguard rights that are practical and effective. It had to look behind appearances and investigate the realities of the situation complained of. Thus, while they have a wide margin of appreciation in assessing the existence of a problem of public concern warranting specific measures and in implementing social and economic policies where an issue in the general interest is at stake, it is incumbent on the public authorities to act in good time, in an appropriate manner, and with utmost consistency. While the Convention does not impose an obligation on the states to restore confiscated assets, let alone to dispose of them in accordance with the elements of the right of property, once a solution has been adopted by a state, it must be implemented with reasonable clarity and coherence in order to avoid, in so far as possible, legal uncertainty and ambiguity for the legal persons concerned by the measures to implement it. In that context, it should be stressed that uncertainty, be it legislative, administrative, or arising from practices applied by the authorities, is an important factor to be taken into account in assessing the state's conduct. In addition, each contracting state must equip itself with an adequate and sufficient legal arsenal to ensure compliance with the positive obligation imposed on it. The court's sole task is to consider whether in the instant case the measures taken by the Romanian authorities were adequate and effective. The European Court noted that after the entry into force of Law Number 10 per 2001, the applicant was unable to recover possession of the parts of his property that had not been returned since the combined effect of sections 18D and 46(2) of Law Number 10, 2001, afforded him merely the possibility of pecuniary restoration. In addition, it was no longer open to him to bring an action for recovery of possession against the purchaser under ordinary law. Even supposing that he could have brought such an action, his chances of success would have been uncertain, given the Supreme Court of Justice consistent case law, which systematically dismissed actions for recovery of possession where it found that the purchaser had acted in good faith. This unenforceable change in the case law had the effect of depriving the applicant of any reasonable possibility of recovering possession of the flat sold to the former tenants, as he could legitimately have expected to do previously under the final judgment of 10 April 1997. This change seems to have been facilitated by the lack of an appropriate legal framework and of appropriate administrative and judicial practice on the legal questions related to the sale of someone else's property, appearances in law and the applicable rules in this area, which definitively prevented the applicant from realizing the legitimate expectation arising from the judgment of 10 April 97, namely of having his entire property returned to him. In conclusion, the European Court of Human Rights noted that the state has failed to discharge its positive obligation to take timely and consistent action to address the issue of general interest raised by the return of or sale of property transferred to state ownership under nationalization decrees. The general uncertainty thus created had repercussions for the applicant, who was unable to recover his entire property, even though he had obtained a final judgment ordering the state to return it to him. Consequently, the state has failed to comply with its obligation to recognize the applicant's right to the effective enjoyment of his possessions as guaranteed by Article 1 of Protocol Number 1, thus upsetting the fair balance between the demands of the public interest and the need to protect the applicant's right to the peaceful enjoyment of his possessions. Consequently, there has been a violation of Article 1 of Protocol Number 1, paragraph under 112 and 113. The example of European Court judgments pronounced against Romania can very well continue. In this context, the European Court delivered the pilot judgment of 12 October 2010 in Maria Atanasiu and others versus Romania. The respondent state must take measures to ensure effective protection of the rights guaranteed by Article 6, number 1, Article 6.1, and the Convention of Article 1 of Protocol Number 1 in the context of all the cases similar to the present case, in accordance with the principles enshrined in the Convention. These measures must be put in place within 18 months from the date on which the present judgment becomes final. To adjourn for 18 months from the date on which the present judgment becomes final, examination of all applications stemming from the same general problem without prejudice to the court's power to declare inadmissible any such case or to take note of a friendly settlement between the parties in accordance with Article 37 or 39 of the Convention. Following the delivery of the pilot judgment, the Romanian Parliament adopted Law Number 165 of 16 May 2013 on finalization of the process of physical restitution or alternative compensation in respect of immovable property that wrongly passed into state ownership during the communist regime, a law adopted by means of government's assumptions of responsibility and upon which initiation the principle of priority of the restitution in kind was taken into account. The law was subject to the a priori constitutional review exercised by the Constitutional Court. The court delivered decision number 232 of 10 May 2013, whereby it dismissed as unfounded the exception of unconstitutionality in relation to the challenges brought. Thus, the applicants raised both extrinsic and intrinsic challenges of unconstitutionality. They argued that the date on which the government has assumed responsibility over the said law, a legislative initiative with the same object, had been sent to the Senate and had not yet been placed on the agenda for parliamentary debate, and therefore the government could not assume responsibility on a bill that had identically regulatory purposes. Responding to this challenge, the court held that the government has not assumed responsibility on a bill in parliamentary procedure, but on another bill that was not under such a procedure. A legislative proposal, such as the own mentioned by the applicants, sent to the Senate as first notified chamber, does not prevent the government to assume responsibility on a new bill. Otherwise, we might find ourselves in a situation where the government could only assume responsibility on bills aimed at areas other than those referred to in the proposal or bills in parliamentary procedure, which is tantamount to a restriction on the government's right to assume responsibility under Article 1014 of the Constitution. It is reasoning part of his decision. The court noted that the impugned law does not represent a unique and uniform regulation in the matter of restitution of property abusively taken during the communist regime, and several parallel regulations are still in force under various normative acts, which means that the law has not achieved an overhaul of the legislation in the matter. The presentation is too long, and we suggest to stop here.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation.